There were three ravens sat on a tree. Down a down, hey, down a down. They were as black as they might be with a down. One of them said to his mate, where shall we our breakfast take? With a down, derry, 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 down, down.
Hello and welcome to a bonus episode of the Three Ravens podcast. We're on a break at the moment, researching and writing our fourth series, but to fill the gap, this is the last of three new compilation episodes containing a trio of stories from across our earlier series. We've entitled this episode Three More Witches because, well, it contains three more of our witch stories. We write quite a few, so it seems, though these are corkers, even if we say so ourselves. They include our Cumberland story, Long Meg and Her Daughters, our Essex story, Three Knots, and our Leicestershire story, Black Annis. If you'd like to support the podcast and access all of our episodes ad-free, as well as tons of additional content like monthly exclusive episodes, episodes of the Three Ravens Film Club, our newsletter, stories as text versions, and more, do consider signing up to our Patreon at patreon.com/Three Ravens Podcast. Indeed, our new Three Ravens Film Club episode about The Devil Rides Out will be released on Thursday. Christopher Lee on top form. We hope you enjoy it. And next Monday, we'll be back with our third ever listener episode. So it's all happening. Otherwise, for our archive of all past episodes and expanded information for each episode, as well as our shop full of Three Ravens merch, please visit our website at threeravenspodcast.com. We'll speak to you soon, and in the meantime, we'll start spinning our yarns right after this. Once there were 77 great stone circles in Cumberland. Some still stand, such as the stones of Souther Fell, where ghostly armies march by night. There's the Castlerigg Stones, second largest in all of England, and the Maybergh Henge, left half buried in the earth since old John Lesh dug one out to build his house and went mad within a week. At Eamont Bridge there's the Round Table, said to be the site of King Arthur's final battle, and the Swinside Stones, where the folk of Sunken Kirk tried to raise their church, only, well, the devil kept pulling it down. But no stone circle in Cumbria has half the fame as Long Meg and Her Daughters. And though others might fall, she never will. Not until the curse is broken. Few dare so much as touch Long Meg. Some brave soul once set about trying to carve his name in her, but no sooner had his blade touched the stone than it sprang with blood and a storm blew in overhead. Poor fool must not have known of the hex laid upon her by the wizard Michael Scott, he who froze old Meg and all her kin that bright Sabbath day. For she was famous in her time, Meg of Meldon, the flame-haired daughter of William Fenwick, known to all nearby as the Heron Lord. He was the master of Harrington Hall and wanted a son. He never got one, and once Meg grew tall, she was married off, as was the way in those times. So tall was she that some thought her ugly, and others called her a giant, but she mothered seven girls well enough, much to her husband's shame and rage. Like Meg's father, her husband wanted a male heir, and with no boys forthcoming, he took to drink. It was no matter to Meg, who, out of nowhere, found and raised a pup to keep her company. A black mongrel, it grew and grew, and it said that when the hound barked, the rain would start falling, and when it growled, the clouds would turn grey up above. One day, so it said, ripe with drink, Meg's husband fell from his horse and passed on. So Meg went back to her father, seeking money, and by then the old man was on his deathbed, and old William Fenwick wouldn't give her a bean, no matter how loud the dog growled. And when he died, at a great flash of lightning, some second cousin became the Heron Lord, and that was that. So it was that Meg went from village to village, from Penrith to Armathwaite, Winfell to Kirkoswald, raging until the air turned black with her words about the ways of menfolk. Sure enough, her seven daughters followed, and like the Fenwicks from time immemorial, those girls had magic in the blood. They knew the power of the stones of Cumbria, studied the hedges and the druids' ancient rites, and so many of the women who heard of Long Meg's calls dropped their stitching, left their bread half-baked, and walked away with the butter unchurned. It's said over 100 women followed Meg out into the Pennine Hills. Word was they lived there together in the caves, hunting and fishing, farming and trading with the folk of Windskill, Solkeld and Glastonbury. They never went to church and never spoke to menfolk at all. And people came to them for help, cures for the sick, help for the lame, spells for those who were most in need. All one had to do was walk into the wilderness, and there the black dog would find them, leading them to a quiet place where a sister would meet them to do business. Of course, word spread soon enough, not least of the dances Long Meg led on the wilds in all weathers. They would travel to the stones across Cumbria for their rites. Some said there were sacrifices, fires lit, and wailing songs that would last from dawn until dark. All that noise carried on the wind, well, it drew Michael Scott, and in him, Long Meg met her match. You see, Scott was a wizard, no bones about it. He'd trained as a priest at Oxford, learning Latin and Greek. Then he went to Paris, learned Hebrew, went to Bologna, learned Italian, and he trained in Arabic at Toledo, unlocking the wisdoms of the East and West. He travelled on right into Africa, living for a time with the Tuareg people of the Sahara. He solved the secrets of the rainbow, wrote on astrology, alchemy, physiognomy, and the occult, helping Fibonacci with his book on mathematics, which is dedicated to him if you check. When word reached him of Long Meg, he was in Norway, where he was showing the same trick he'd done in France and Spain, having feasts served by spirits he'd summoned out of the shadows of the room. And by then he'd learned of the manner in which he himself would die, which the spirits told him would be by a stone striking his skull. So day and night Michael Scott wore a metal cap under his hood, never removing it and thinking to live forever. So it was that Michael Scott sailed to Cumberland, drawn by the rumours of Long Meg. And though he spoke to the Lord Bishop of Carlisle, it seemed none of the priests of the county would dare head out into the wilds to see Meg. All were afraid, having seen the storms above her dances, heard her music on the wind, and learned of the many who were willing to follow her, seemingly to hell and back. He was a brave man, Michael Scott, for as much as he was a wizard, he was also flesh and blood, and though he ventured over the foothills by Thack Moor and through Hartside Pass, everywhere he went a great black dog followed him, watching from not far off. The beast, which some said grew as big as a horse, brought with it gales and lightning and floods, and when Michael Scott battled the weather, it only grew worse, the hound mocking his steps. Yet Michael Scott was cunning too, and so he laid a trap. For that year, midsummer fell on a Sabbath day, and from studying the stars, the old wizard knew just which stones Meg would choose to dance at. He laid in wait, hiding himself in the helm wind blowing off Crossfell, waiting for Meg to appear. Appear she did, with her 100 followers. It said they stripped down to their nakedness, the sisters in a broad ring all about Long Meg, who was covered in blood as red as her flowing hair. She set about dancing, calling the storms, thanking the spirits for their service. And her black hound was there, and the sisters were singing, but little did they know that in calling the storm, they called Michael Scott, who rode the helm wind right to them. When the old wizard appeared before the women, all gasped in horror, and though they roared and raged with the witches being of the air, Michael Scott laid down a curse of the earth, turning them all to stone. Though the daughters in the ring, all mingled with the ancient rocks laid down by the druids and the men of old times, each transmuting to granite, Meg had a special fate. For her stone was red, red as her hair, red as the blood on her skin. And the hex Michael Scott laid on her was such that only a soul who could count all those stones in the ring three times round and come out with the same number would free Long Meg. But the stones there, well, they move, you see. They're never in the same place twice, which is how Long Meg and her daughters were trapped and still are sealed in rock forevermore. Of course, everyone in Cumberland knows Long Meg's hound still roams the hills and fells, watching and waiting and bringing the weather. And don't think Michael Scott got off scot-free, either. For, as Dante wrote in his Inferno, Michael Scott, the greatest wizard of his day, went to the devil, just as he always should have. After laying his hex, you see, Scott went back to Carlisle Cathedral and set himself down to pray. Only the Lord Bishop bade the wizard remove his skull cap while he knelt to ask for forgiveness. It just so happened that a loose stone from high above on the cathedral ceiling fell down and struck Michael Scott right on the top of his head. He was killed in the blink of an eye, and as an unholy man who died unshriven, his body was laid in an unmarked grave, its location a mystery to this day. And though Michael Scott is long dead, Long Meg and her daughters are far from it. For those old stones live and listen and learn. And one day, some bright spark will count those rocks. And then Long Meg will be free.
The wind is a wild soul and hard to tame. It cannot be pinned for long, and it laughs away every attempt. Even those who think they can contain it have their spirits broken, for the wind will always dance away. People who can control its rough magic are few, and you may never meet one. One such soul was Sarah Moore. She knew the secrets of the wind and some of the secrets of the sea as well, although it has too many to ever know fully. Gulls perched on her shoulders and told her tales of their flights to distant shores, and shimmering fish jumped from the water to giggle at her jokes. Sarah Moore was strong and tall, and the four winds liked to play in her storm grey hair. She had quick, clever fingers, and she wove charms from colourful wool and twisted net fibres. Sarah's speciality was harnessing the wind into her knotted charms, which she gave to sailors to afford them a little extra help. The knots she wove were intricate and beautiful, and each charm was like a tiny picture of something nobody could fully see, the dance of the wind. She created many different sorts, but the one she most often gave to others was a charm of three knots. Three knots Sarah tied into her charms, and each knot had a different purpose. A sailor could carry her charm aboard and, as needed, untie a knot. The release of the first knot would produce a light breeze, just enough to catch the sails of a ship at first. The second knot let out a strong wind which could carry a ship to its intended point much faster. But Sarah always tied a third knot into her charms, a balance of sorts, which she told sailors never to use. Within that third knot, a storm was contained, and if it was released, it might rage unchecked until it had claimed something from the seas. Most people listened to Sarah when she warned them not to use the third knot, but there are always exceptions. For instance, I heard of a man over from Sheerness who used one of Sarah Moore's charms. I don't know why he'd come to Leon Sea to do his wife's shopping, but he had a list and he'd made the trip. The shopping was done quickly and cheaply, and this man decided he'd spend the rest of his day in the quayside inns. Still, when the sun started to get low, he thought he'd better start for home to avoid angering his good lady. Worry beset him when the waters were calm, with no wind to catch a sail. Luckily for him, Sarah Moore was walking along the quay, feeding the seabirds, and she offered to sell him a charm. Just like she always did, she told him never to use the third knot, and he nodded and he paid her. Well, this chap was just delighted. He released the knot, and a light breeze fluttered through his sails and set him on course to sail back to Sheerness. He was enjoying the sunset, looking over the bows, when he thought it was still quite a distance home, and that he might just have a little more wind, just to help him get along a little faster. So he took out Sarah's charm, and he untied the second knot. Oh, didn't he get along beautifully then? The ship cut through the water like a cormorant skimming along the surface, and this man thought there was nothing better. He decided he'd never do the shopping anywhere but Lee-on-Sea. But the sun had dipped well and truly below the horizon by then, and he thought of his wife waiting back home in Sheerness, wanting the things he'd bought, and he thought perhaps he'd just have a little more speed, just to get home faster. Sarah's charm had worked so beautifully up until now that he could just imagine how it would be with a little more wind. So he let out the final knot and held onto the mast, ready to fly into Sheerness port like a shooting star. Well, just as he'd been warned, a fearsome storm blew up. It battered and buffeted at his ship, and he had a job to cling onto the mast. He was lucky not to be sunk or dashed to pieces, but on that occasion, the wind fiercely blew the ship off course, away from Sheerness, and all the way back to Lee-on-Sea. And who should be waiting for him on the quayside but Sarah Moore, with her hands on her hips and a smile on her face, and what did she say but "I told you so"? But most of the time, the people who used Sarah's charms listened to her words and were well satisfied with the service. Of course, it wasn't free. Magic had a price, and Sarah Moore charged it happily. Selling her spells kept her cottage by the sea well supplied with salty fish and red-heeled shoes, and it was a happy place filled with pretty shells and gulls' feathers and dangling charms made of sea glass. Most days she sat outside on the Lee harbour side, talking to the winds and watching the ships, and selling her charms to anyone who wanted them. The people in Lee-on-Sea accepted Sarah Moore as part of the scenery, as much a feature of their landscape as the sea or the sky. But one day, a foreign ship sailed into Lee. A mercenary crew had come to patrol the seas and keep them safe from the threat of invasion. The captain was a solemn, cold man who had read the words of Matthew Hopkins and others, and when he looked at Sarah Moore with her twists of thread and her chattering birds, he only saw a witch. When he passed her on the quay, he spat at her feet, and he told his men not to buy her charms at any cost. About the town of Lee, he spread vicious rumours about Sarah, telling people that she'd sold her soul to the devil and that the seabirds she fed were her hellish familiars. At first, nobody listened, but the insidious talk gradually spread, and the sailors and fishermen who'd bought charms from Sarah for years started to avoid her too. Sarah soon found that people stopped saying good morning to her, and she wasn't welcome in the pubs she always went to. Even the landlady of the Bent Bowsprit Inn, who'd been her friend, was rude to her, and Sarah started to feel as though Lee-on-Sea wasn't the happy home it had always been. It didn't take very long for her to trace the problem back to the foreign captain. His rude remarks and the way he crossed himself whenever he passed her or clutched at his silver crucifix, and the way he pointed at her and muttered things to his crew, oh, he was the source of it all right. Now, Sarah Moore was no wallflower, so she lost no time in marching up to the captain's ship the next time it was in dock and confronting him. But he didn't have the grace or the face to speak to her. He turned away and shut himself in his cabin and wouldn't meet her eyes. "You'll see," said Sarah Moore. "You'll see." For she was full of a tearing fury, spiralling through her like a whirlwind, and she vowed to have her revenge on the foreign captain and his shipmates. The captain opened his sea chest and looked into his Book of Maleficium, and after long hours of pondering, he had an idea of what to do about Sarah Moore, but he kept it to himself for a little while in case nothing happened at all. After all, the coldness of old friends is sometimes enough to send someone away from the home they've loved. But Sarah wasn't to be seen off so easily. Her anger was growing as rain swells a dark cloud. The next overcast day, when the captain sailed his ship out to patrol the estuary, Sarah Moore stood on the quay with a bundle of threads in her hands. As she stared at the ship, she twisted the threads into a new dark shape, not her usual three knots, but a tangled, bramble-spiked knot of malice. And she tossed that oily dark thing into the air until a whispering wind caught it and carried it right to the top of the mast of the captain's ship. There it tangled itself around and around, and when Sarah Moore spoke some words to it, it stuck fast as though it had been carved into the grain of the wood. The knot began to glow, drawing the storm clouds around itself in a web of wind and rain, until it was the eye of a fearsome storm which raged only about that ship, for Sarah Moore had no anger in her heart towards the other sailors and fishermen of Lee. But around the bows of that ship, the estuary churned and roared. The crew clung to the masts and the bows, their stomachs rolling as they went for the barrels of rum, vowing not to die sober if they had to go that day. The captain stood at the wheel, and as he looked back towards Lee, he saw Sarah on the shore, and he knew that the time had come to put into practice the things his Book of Maleficium had told him. He knew that a witch needs a connection, a magical link to the spell she's cast. So he looked around for the source of the raging wind and rain, and he saw the glowing knot at the top of the mast. All in a trice, he ran to fetch the great axe he kept in his cabin, a relic from another life, and he swung it back and chopped into the ship's mast as though he were cutting down a great tree in a forest. Righteous fire fueled his strokes, and in three chops the mast was toppling from its great height and crashing into the waves below. As soon as the mast hit the surface of the water, the storm stilled. The sailors cheered the bravery of their captain, and they didn't mind that they had to row all the way back to the harbour, for they all knew how close they'd come to dying that day. They knew that the burn in their muscles from pulling at the oars would soon be relieved by strong liquor and prayers of thanks that their captain's foresight and knowledge had saved their lives. But when they arrived back at the quay in Lee, there were no bright smiles or words of welcome for their safe return. Instead, they found a group of people gathered around a fallen shape lying near the harbour wall. It was the dead body of Sarah Moore, lying in a pool of her own blood, with three great axe wounds sliced across her chest. Nobody in Lee knew exactly what the captain had done, but they knew he was to blame. It didn't take long before they forgot that they'd listened to him and colluded in Sarah's misfortune. Lee-on-Sea made it quite clear that the captain wasn't welcome there anymore, not in any of the pubs, and nor were any of his crew. Soon enough, they set sail for other waters, and they weren't seen again in those parts. The landlady of the Bent Bowsprit Inn changed its name to the Sarah Moore, in honour of the Witch of the Winds, and it remains named for her to this very day, though it's a long time now since she sold her charms by the sea there. Many a sailor has wished he held three knots in his hand to unleash a wind, and many more has longed for the spells Sarah wove to keep them safe at sea. But as for Sarah, she lives on in the winds which lift the waves into carrying ripples, and in the fluffy clouds which darken with the rain. If her spirit takes a fancy to a handsome seafarer, she might help a ship along by blowing a breeze through its sails. But too much zealotry and cold looks aboard, and Sarah Moore might just knot her spirit around the mast and whip up a fatal storm. And so my tale is told, and now it belongs to you.
Long ago, between the banks of the River Soar and Rothley Brook, Leicester Forest stood tall and dark and wild. The Earls of Leicester hunted there, staining the earth with the blood of beasts caught on their spears, and out of that unholy ground grew men of an unholy order. For centuries, the monks of Leicester Abbey were known as Black Canons. They dressed as shadows, rearing, barking hounds which fouled the flagstones of the houses of God. If you wander the ruins of Leicester Abbey now, then you will find, amongst the grass and rubble, the ghost of Cardinal Wolsey, who died there en route to his trial for treason. That place was ever a den of corruption, and few wept when it was razed to the ground in the dissolution. But fire liked that place, whether the fires of hell or some other primal force. The blackened stones were used to build Cavendish House, but by 1645 that too had burned, licked by the lapping tongues of flame. This left little but a mess of jagged ruins, haunted by the spectres who freely wander the remains of Abbey Park. Centuries before, however, Leicester Abbey had held a prisoner whose soul was destined for a darker fate. A hostage of Richard of York, the hunchbacked cripple king who sallied forth in 1485 and left his own blood in the earth of Bosworth Field. Though he perished there, hacked to death amid the clashing chaos of the fray, his corpse was ridden back to Leicester naked and slung into the choir of Greyfriars Church to be forgotten. Yet Richard had known he was riding to his doom that day, having sought wisdom from the very soul whose name echoes in infamy, Black Annis, a seer he kept in his bitter retinue. Though her legend now is monstrous, she was once a holy maid. Her name was Agnes Scott, and she was one of many hostages Richard kept to dampen the fury of his foes. A bastard daughter of Edward IV and his mistress witch Jane Shore, Agnes carried her mother's gifts within her blood. Unlike Jane, who'd honed her talents out of books found in her lover's libraries, Agnes had no such advantage. While her mother had been known as the Rose of London, charming Thomas More, William Hastings, and Thomas Lynham, the King's Solicitor General, Agnes was like her uncle. Born with a twisted spine, the only hints of her royal lineage shone through her moon-white skin, pale and spider-webbed with dark blue veins. Her eyes were red and wet with ever-flowing tears, and from girlhood, Richard coveted the wisdom she offered, hating her all the more for being so ugly, so malformed, and so much his own crooked shadow. It was Agnes who told him, "Where your spur should strike on the ride into battle, your head shall be broken on the return." Her prophecy came true, though no sooner had it slipped through her youthful lips than Richard had struck her for it. He'd sent her from there to the care of the abbot, but on the ride to Bosworth Field, the king's spur struck the bridge stone of Leicester's Bow Bridge. The Dark Omen's second part was realized when his corpse was carried back from his great defeat, the dead king's mangled skull striking the same stone and breaking open, just as his niece had warned. While Richard had died in infamy, Agnes had been kept locked in a cell by the Black Canons. When Henry Tudor ascended to the throne, she was then spirited away, and for years she lived as an anchoress, locked within a simple cell beneath St. Martin's Church. To keep off the rats, cats became her companions, with the poor of Leicester coming to hear her holy wisdom. She was screened from the public sight by a leather curtain which was stretched and pinned over the hagioscope which bordered the street. Through this squint-slight window, she told passers-by of her dreams, offered help in times of trouble and advice in all matters. Through another slot, she was fed, though only the simplest food, and through a third, she heard Mass and could view St. Martin's altar. But in all weathers, all seasons, that place was her home, through sickness, health, hot summers and long winters. From her cell, Agnes heard the construction of Wigston's house, listened to the talk of rolling sicknesses, of changes in the nation's fate. But while bishops and abbots grew old and died, Agnes lived on and on, her feline friends keeping her warm, bringing her news of the outside, slipping through the holes in the walls through which she could only peer. Generations of cats all through the city knew her name, and some said she learned to change shape to become a cat herself, visiting the fishmongers at High Cross and stalking the Saturday shambles in Market Square, hunting for bargains. As the new century unfurled, the Guild of Corpus Christi was dissolved, and St. Martin's Church, which had stood since the times of Pender of Mercia, fell into disrepair. The bricks of her cell were removed to be sold, and Agnes moved on, seeking ways to use her wisdom elsewhere. For a time, she took up residence at the leper colony at Burton-les-Arts, hiding her own ageless, deformed shape in much the same manner as the ailing souls she served. Though wrapped in lengths of cloth and surrounded by the dying and the damned, she was feared and pitied, even in spite of her good works. And alas, even the Order of St. Lazarus was not exempt from the fires of the disillusion, so Agnes journeyed back into Leicester Forest, finding there, in that blood-rich earth, a hollow in a cave at the top of Dane Hill to finally call her home. By then, the woods about that place were thinned, felled to fuel the growth of Leicester and the villages nearby. In the places where lords had ridden in thundering blood sport, calm had settled, men rearing long wool sheep and minding them in the meadows thereabouts. But as years rolled by, rumours grew of the woman who lived in the cave at the hill's top. She had taken to pinning sheets of leather over the hollows in the rocks, hiding herself from view. Some brave souls went to her grotto seeking wisdom and cures, but all about, perched in the trees, cats watched and stalked and hissed, guarding her from unwanted visitation. In payment, it was said she accepted lambs, which she reared and, so it was said, slaughtered in strange rites. Others left her gifts of gold, though she never made to spend it. Some said she had a hoard of treasure, and greedy men from time to time would try to lure her out to steal it. To do so, they would catch a cat and kill it, dousing the beast's remains in aniseed, tying it with rope and riding by her cave, dragging the creature's tiny corpse behind. Yet it never worked, though on moonlit nights many spoke of the blue-skinned hag who roamed Dane Hill, the sky filled with yowling, the trees marked by claw-like slashes from the creature none saw but all knew as Black Annis. Though one man did see her and lived to tell of it. His name was Bailey Drover, and he hailed from Thorpe Astley, born of humble stock.
His son, Folk, was his helper, and together they led their flock from Enderby to Peckerton, on to Ratby and back down, ever fearful to avoid Dane Hill, as all folks did. Alas, one day, while Bailey and his boy were leading their sheep from Glenfield down to Braunston, one fled, running deeper into the forest, and Folk gave chase, headed off towards Black Annis Hollow. Bailey well knew that his son had heard the tales and would never risk meddling with the witch woman of Dane Hill. Yet, as afternoon moved towards night, Folk did not return, and Bailey determined he had little choice but to go off in search of his son. He took his shepherd's crook with him, a dagger tucked into his belt, and a flaming torch to light his way. And as he wandered Leicester Forest, he heard them in the trees, the cats, spitting, mewling, skittering through the dark. They warned him off, telling him to stalk no further into that domain with such dark thoughts in his heart. His jaw grimly set, Bailey pulled wool from his coat, twirling it to stuff his ears. This blocked out the wailing of the beasts whose eyes glinted in the dark. Yet they watched him still, their tails twitching, considering whether or not to pounce, his breath rattling out as jets of steam floating aimless through the night air. Where he walked, twigs snapped, which to him seemed like the cracking of children's bones. And the wind roved through the trees, the branches shaking, blocking the stars from above, though he heard nothing save his own pulse thundering in his ears. In time, he saw through the trees the orange glow of a fire burning. He extinguished his torch and moved towards it, the shapes of cats moving to keep pace with his passing. And in time, he came to see about the fire a shape dressed in rags which trailed about the campfire. It was the witch, he knew, and atop the blaze was a cauldron bubbling. He watched as she tipped herbs from wooden bowls into the kettle, stirring them with a black iron ladle, the cave behind her said to have been dug with the witch's own monstrous claws. Crouching low, Bailey hid behind some briars, peering about for signs of his son. As he did, he smelled the stench of tanning and noticed all through the trees hung up in frames, leather drying, the skins he feared of Black Annis's victims. And though he could not hear her, he saw the shrouded figure's lips moving. It was an incantation, he knew, which sounded like a haunting lullaby, a song she was singing over a small, shadowy form. His heart ran cold as Bailey saw that shape. It was Folk, his boy, laid out on a pallet of sheep's wool and dry leaves. And beside Folk was the lost sheep, tethered to a pole as if ready, like his son, to be slaughtered. Gathering his nerves, Bailey drew his blade, standing and dashing out of his hiding place. As he ran, cats skittered and yowled, some tripping him, others darting across his path, all seeming as demons, black in the shadows cast by the fire. And Bailey raised his blade, dashing towards Black Annis, seeking to bring the dagger down into the witch's black heart and end her nights of terror up in that savage place. The shrouded woman turned as he ran towards her, raising her hands, screaming in broken-toothed terror. Bailey saw her long, dirty, talon-like fingernails roaring, and the crone fell away, muttering, begging. Yet Bailey's ears were blocked and he could not hear a word she said. Instead, he closed in on her, backing her against the wall by the entrance to her cave, seeing her look desperately from Folk's pallet towards Bailey and back again. Bailey saw her lips moving and twisted his own, horrified by the red-eyed face he saw. And what he failed to hear was Agnes Scott's entreaties that he stop, be careful, for Folk was awake. This was because she had found the boy injured, fallen in a gully, and had brought him to her grotto for food and rest. She'd helped the boy to find the lost sheep and secured it until morning, when it would be safer to make the return journey. And in those brief hours, looking with his innocent eyes, Folk had seen Agnes as anything but a monster. A kind soul, patient, fearful, yet mild, he'd laughed with her, prayed with her, and come to think of Black Annis as his friend. It was the boy's instincts which impelled him to leap to his feet and dash forward, his good heart which saw him run between Black Annis and his father's blade. But all was doubly in vain, for as Bailey's dagger slashed through the dark, he did not hear his son's last words, nor did he slay his intended target. Instead, he plunged the blade deep into his own son's heart, killing him stone dead. Appalled by his crimes, the shepherd staggered back, falling and knocking Agnes's cauldron. The boiling contents spilled over him, the bubbling stew scorching his eyes, blinding him forevermore. The rest of Agnes' night was spent in tending to Bailey Drover. She saved his life, though his face was scarred forevermore. The clods of wool within his ears were extracted, and she sang to him, whispering calming words as he drifted in and out of consciousness. And all about them, the cats sang to the stars, mewling over the death of Folk, who is buried not far off in earth all too accustomed to slaughter. The following day, Agnes led the blind shepherd back down from Dane Hill, guiding his steps. But without his sight, Bailey Drover could never again find his way back up to Black Annis's Hollow. And though he told all who would listen that their rumours were not true, that the blue-faced hag they all called Black Annis was no monster or beast with a taste for human flesh, her dark legend only grew. The drag hunts continued, the dead cats ridden on by her bower. Songs were written in fear of her, windows built smaller to stop her fitting through, and hung with charms and bundles of herbs. Yet all the cats of Leicestershire know her, and if you ask them they will say so, attesting that to this day Black Annis will run with them at midnight and feed them milk from wooden bowls and stroke them with her long-nailed fingers. Alas, this is the way with ugly things. People make up stories far darker than the truth, for if they are not maligned, then they are forgotten, no matter how good they may be of heart, or how kind they are, in spite of all the cruelties of the world.
God sent every gentleman, such hounds, such hawks, and such leman, with a down, derry, derry.